I am relieved that even the great Muslim Council of Britain suffers the problems that all Muslim organizations across the world suffer from. We hold each other accountable for the funds. We demand our right to question, and we certainly assert our ownership over the organization, and that, I think, is how it should be. If we cannot practice accountability, democracy, freedom of expression within our organizations, we cannot hold it up for a standard, especially in a Muslim world that is as troubled as what it is. My dear brothers and sisters, this is indeed a difficult time to be a member of the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not because Islam is difficult, not because Allah subhanahu makes things difficult for us, but simply because we live in a world in which we are misunderstood and in which we cause misunderstanding. We live in a world that does horrible things to us, and where some of us do horrible things in the name of Islam. We live in a world where in our heartlands, where we are majorities, we face dictatorships, we face coup d'etats, we face authoritarian regimes, we face the absence of democracy, of freedom, of human rights, and we face all kinds of challenges where we are a majority. And where we are a minority, we face challenges of Islamophobia, of suspicion, of stereotyping, and all manner of means, as the countries that we have moved to, where our fathers and our grandparents have moved to, begin to turn to the right and begin to look for the easy scapegoats in society. And so many of us from amongst ourselves give them every excuse and even give them the sticks with which to beat us. This is almost reminiscent, as I may have said 7 years ago, of the time of the early Muslims in the Meccan crucible, when Islam was new. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had been one of the most accepted people from the most respectable tribes and the most respectable families, and had been secured his place in the life of Quraysh as a member of the Banu Hashim. The moment he came with La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, life changed completely. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes this condition in Surah Buruj, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا نَقُمُوا مِنْهُمْ إِلَّا أَن يُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ. They were persecuted for no reason except that they believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The early Muslims experienced this difficulty in the early years of Islam in Makkah. We all remember the assassination of Sumayya. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with her, the first martyr of Islam. We remember the torch of Sayyidina Bilal. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him. We remember the humiliation of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam at Ta'if in Makkah and everywhere he went. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put peace and blessings on the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We remember the boycott of the early Muslims, when for 2 years no one did business with them and they were isolated, humiliated, and starved. And in the midst of all of this, they raised their eyes and their hands to the heavens and they shouted, Mata Nasrullah, when is the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala coming? And Allah's promise to us is true. Nasrum min Allah wa fathun qareeb. Help from Allah will come and a speedy victory. And so, as Sheikh Raed Salah once told me when he visited Cape Town, he said the Palestinians have learned not to make dua for a lighter load, but to make dua for stronger shoulders. So this isn't the time for us to cry for a lighter load when we face all of these problems. This is the time for us to make dua for bigger shoulders, for stronger shoulders, for broader shoulders, and for support for each other, that inshallah we may survive all of these trials and tribulations that we go through. It was just a few months, maybe a year or two, before the hijrah, before the early Muslims decided that they should leave the crucible of Makkah and to take up the offer of a safe haven in Madinatul Munawwara, or in Yathrib as it was known at that point. Just a few Months before that, Hijrah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a surah, in a few verses that comes, as I related to Islamic Relief a few weeks ago, that comes in Surah Ar-Rum, the verses, the chapter on Rome. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the opening of that surah, Ghulibat Ar-Rum, Rome has been defeated. And the question is, how does the Quran do breaking news? How does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give a news flash to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Why is it important that as a defeat happens for Rome nearby, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Rome has been defeated in a place not far from here? It had to be consequential, because many battles were fought in the world at that moment. Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveal to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that Rome had just been defeated in a place not far from here? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues to say, but it is a temporary victory. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, in the meantime, happy will be the believers. My respected brothers and sisters, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was saying to the Muslims at that time, that the world as they knew it then was going to undergo a transition, that the two superpowers of the time, the Roman Empire and the Persian Empire, had fought each other in a series of battles to a standstill. They had exhausted their resources, they had lost the appetite for war, and they needed to go back to rebuild their stocks, to replenish their armies, to get their supplies going again, and to get their populations interested in war again. And this interregnum, this interruption in the war of the time, lasted about 10 years, just short of 10 years. But that was the crucial 10 years, because after 13 years in the Meccan crucible, suffering, humiliated, being assassinated, being targeted, and everything like that, they made the move with a hijrah. They made the move to Medina. There they found sanctuary. And there, with the allies, the superpower ally of the Quraysh, exhausted, they could now dream of establishing the community of early Muslims. They used the period to consolidate themselves. They used the period to strengthen themselves, both in iman and in numbers, as well as in resolve. Their confidence levels were raised so that they could even go and meet the Quraysh at Badr and defeat them with an inferior army. A purely defensive maneuver, because they did not call out the war. But they were confident enough to go and meet them. Why do I tell you this? Because I believe that despite the hardship of the time, this is not the time for us to be despairing. This is not the time for us to internalize victimhood. This is not the time for us to turn in on each other. This is the time for us to look for that moment of relief. Because a part of the problem is in the inability of the superpowers of today to assert themselves. America, the United States of America, is $16 trillion US dollars in deficit as a result of the wars they have fought. They have not passed a budget for the last 4 years. They are raising the borrowing ceiling all the time, so much have they been bankrupted by the wars they have fought. When President Obama tried to appeal to the American people for an attack on Syria, only 27% of Americans said that they wanted another war. Their population is tired of seeing body bags return and the flags flying at half mast with every death that they have in the US Army. Their allies have no money to invest in a war machine, and so only they can rely on the United States to fight the fights that they want to fight. Some of us may feel disappointed that they've not intervened in Syria. Others may feel elated that the militarism has been interrupted. The question that the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has to ask itself today is, what do we do with this interregnum? Do we have the leadership today that was displayed when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam led the early Muslims to the sanctuary of Medina and consolidated the Ummah, gave it a character, gave it a shape, gave it a social form, gave it a constitutional form, entered into alliances and strengthened the Deenul Islam? Do we have the leadership to do this? Or are we going to have a leadership that bickers on the edges, that bickers about the small things, that doesn't understand the big picture, so it deals with the small picture? If we do not occupy this moment, the time will come again, as was the case with the Roman Empire, when Heraclitus reorganized the Roman Empire and then went on the attack against Chosroes and then subsequently defeated the Persian Empire and tried then to stop the spread of Islam. But when they woke up, Islam had strengthened itself so much internally that rethought who they were and had been able to move out of that 10 years of the interregnum, had been able to then move north to the steppes, east to Syria and Iraq, further to Persia, further to India, further to China, and to the west in Spain, and all over North Africa. That was the result of utilizing good leadership in that moment of the interregnum. And so all of us who come to meetings like this with half commitments, all of us who come to meetings like this to fight small fights, all of us who come to meetings like this to defend old turf, must really rethink what it is that we want the MCB to do for us. Because the MCB will be derelict in its duty if it does not understand the global situation as it is, and therefore understand what must be done here in Britain. Because between London and Washington, the major decisions of the world are made. You have not been placed here by accident. Your fathers and your mothers may have come here in desperation. They may have come here to seek a better life. They may have come here to seek the freedom they never had where they were living before. And they may have succeeded in giving their children that opportunity for a better life. Are we here to create a new world, or are we here to create the old world from where we come? If you are here to create the old world, you are in the wrong place, because this world will destroy you. If, however, you are here to want to create this new world, which is safe for difference, where it doesn't matter whether you are Muslim, whether you are black, whether you're a woman, or whoever else you are by way of difference, if you are here to create a new world, then we must have the MCB lead us. And we must give them the parameters and the mandate for that leadership. We want to tell them, we must do great things for us. And that is why it's important for us to imagine this new world, to dream about this new world. But we must imagine it also with the imagination of our parents and our grandparents who came here over the last 50 years. They came here because they did not see the prospect of development and a better life for their children back home. They came here Because they wanted the freedom and not the dictatorship that they had back home. They came here because they wanted a decision-making say in the running of their lives and not the dictates of a king or whoever the case may be. If we dream the old dreams that they escaped, we do them an injustice. We must continue their dream about making this place safe for difference, safe for Muslims, and safe for all people who are different. It is no accident that there is no act of worship in Islam that does not start with the first shart, the first condition being the niyyah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala requires that when you intend to make salah, or when you go to make salah, you must intend to make salah. You don't make salah by accident. The same with wudu, the same with ghusl, the same with fasting, the same with every act in Islam, it starts with the niyyah. Islam brought the world this thing that pop psychologists say today, start with the ending in mind. If you don't understand the end, you can't know how to begin. That's what we taught the world. That's what we purport to do every day. For every waqt that we make salah for every sunnah salah that we perform. And therefore, the question that we ask is, what is our vision of the end? I come from a country, South Africa, that had this wonderful opportunity 20 years ago to reimagine ourselves. Very few countries get that opportunity, and some who get it lose it if they don't use it properly. We have seen how fleeting that moment has been in Egypt. We see the graves on which that dream is buried in Syria. We see the pushback that is happening to the dream in Iraq. We see the strategic retreat, very well considered, alhamdulillah, that is happening in Tunisia to save the dream. We see the difficulty with which that dream is trying to be born in Libya. We are all passionate about so many things, but we are all so unstrategic about so many things. And the thing that connects your end goal with the things that you do now is the strategy. That is the importance of niyyah. It makes you, it forces you to think about your goal so that you can calibrate your steps and ask with every step, is this step taking me to my goal or is it taking me away from my goal? Is it decisively moving forward or is it distracting me on the way? And anything that distracts us is not worthy of our attention. And so, this country, South Africa, when Nelson Mandela was freed in 1990, after massive struggles to free him, we were able to dream a dream, and we were able to interrupt history, and we were able to reimagine ourselves, and we came to the conclusion that we want a fundamentally different world. We want to do the unexpected. We want to display the generosity of spirit. We want to do something that the world does not expect from us. They expected revenge because we were blacks and we were oppressed. They got reconciliation. They expected exclusion because we've been excluded as blacks. They got a unity government. They expected a reverse of apartheid. We gave them the most inclusive society that the world has ever seen. They expected Nelson Mandela to want to govern alone. He included even the last president of apartheid South Africa as his vice president. What the world needs us to do is not to confirm the stereotypes, but to interrupt the stereotypes. Not to do what they expect, but to undo what they expect. Not to display meanness of spirit, but generosity of spirit. That's what we need to be able to do. And that is what this generation is lacking in leadership all over the world today. And therefore, we need to ask, can we disabuse ourselves of the old binaries that have trapped our imagination and our vision for the future? So many of us walk around with mission in life that wherever we are must be a Darul Islam, must be an abode of Islam. Whatever Allah orders must be available for us. Whatever Allah forbids must be out of our way. And if we can't get that, we believe it is Darul Harb, the place of hostility to us, and we are constantly at war with our context. We found in South Africa that between those binaries, there's this wonderful shared society, this wonderful space where we can live and coexist with others, where we can include them, where we can be equal, where we can all have dignity. And that's what we called, as the Muslim community in South Africa, the Darul Shahada, the place for the free profession of our faith, as well as the free profession of other faiths and non-faiths. The Darul Aman, the place of security that comes from the constitution and the country and the government respecting who we are in our essence. The Darul Salam, a place of peace where we can simply get on with our lives and live as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to live. There is this middle ground that we need to construct. We need to deconstruct our fascination that we have this responsibility to establish Sharia where we are, to establish the Islamic State where we are, to have little enclaves that is governed by our own values all the time. And that is the idea of living where you don't make the rules. It is not giving up. It is using the gap in history, that interregnum that I spoke about, in order to consolidate the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very clear to us. When Allah says in Surah Mumtahina, لا ينهاكم الله عن الذين لم يقاتلوكم في الدين ولم يخرجوكم من دياركم أن تبروهم وتقسطوا إليه إن الله يحب المقسطين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to us, Allah does not forbid us from coexisting, from having relations, from co-living with those non-Muslims who do not fight us for our deen and do not drive us from our homes. If they do not do those two things, Allah instructs us to be just with them and to be kind to them, because Allah loves those who are just. You see, when we enter an amana to live here and to do things like we did in South Africa, then we are not only recipients of rights, we are also people with obligations towards that society. And so, how do we fashion out of British society a Darul Shahada, a Darul Aman, and a Darul Salam? What is it that we need to be able to do? And it's a two-way process. As we come to terms with British society must come to terms with itself that has changed. Because you can't have a few million Muslims in Britain, a few million Jamaicans in Britain, a few million Hindus in Britain, a few million Sikhs in Britain, and still say British means white, Anglo-Saxon, English-speaking, fish and chips eating, and Anglican church-going people. But that's not a battle we fight. That is a debate we have. Who will stand up to say to the Prime Minister, Mr. Prime Minister, we agree that we must be British, but let us discuss what it means to be British today, given the reality that we are facing. You see, that's what Nelson Mandela understood. He understood that a non-racial, democratic, non-sexist South Africa is a South Africa of diversity. And therefore you make the laws to include everyone despite their numbers. And that's why the South African Bill of Rights says that all religions are equal. When Nelson Mandela was challenged about it, they said, no, but Christians are 80%. Nelson Mandela said, it's not about the number of people, it's about the equal value of God. What if Muslims tomorrow are 80%? Do we change the rules again? Why don't we make one set of rules that can accommodate all changes that a society goes through, that is fundamentally fair, that gives equality and dignity equally to all people for all time? That has to be the aspiration that we struggle for, to enter that debate. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us to invite all with wisdom and beautiful teachings, not bombs and threats and ugliness and malignant behavior. It's wisdom and beautiful teachings. We are trying to convince people, not to scare people. We are trying to win them over, not to frighten them away. And so we've got to be able to think how it is. And this is not just in Britain. Do you know that the statistics, the demographic statistics of the world tell us today that 90% of countries in the world have significant majorities of at least 10%. Significant minorities of at least 10%. I'm sure the other 10% are largely Muslim countries. So if 90% of countries have significant minorities, it's not just our problem. It is the truth today that 250 million of the Ummah live under conditions of being a minority. We can all speak, and there are some of our theorists who say, don't speak about minorities and majorities. Those are theoretical constructs. You who face challenges here know it's not a theoretical construct. So let's live with the reality and let's plan for the reality. And this is where the notion of living where you don't make the rules come in. How do we begin to persuade people towards our understanding of things? And so we are challenged, firstly, to change the host's conception of themselves and of Britishness and of Americanness and of South Africanness. We need to do that. And we need to show them that this is not a threat. This is not something to fear. That it is in the history of the world, wherever multicultures have collided, has been the moment of the greatest creativity, the greatest creation of knowledge, the greatest innovation in science, the greatest discoveries that the world has known. That is why most of the brilliance of the early Muslims were born where they collided with other cultures. It was when Al-Khawarizmi understood what some of the Europeans were discussing and understood what the Indians were doing on the other side, using the zero, that it revolutionized algorithms, algebra, and a range of other things. It was when we put our knowledge together of astronomy and others put their knowledge of astronomy together that we found the revolution in astronomy and we were able to move forward. It was when we encountered construction techniques amongst the Romans that we could create the arch that became the symbol of our architectural greatness. And so we must present this as an opportunity for British society to renew itself by including the diversity that we and other minorities bring to the table. But we also must change our conception of ourselves. Are we Pakistanis in Britain or are we British Muslims? Are we Indians in Britain or are we British Muslims? Are we Bangladeshis in Britain or are we British Muslims? Because we have this schizophrenia about where we earn our money and where we are loyal to. And so how do we manage a variety of those identities that we all carry without necessarily making the one conflict with the other, but making them all complementary identities? My dear brothers and sisters, in the way in which we strive for this vision of a Daru Shahada, a place for the free confession and profession of our faith, of a place of security and a place of peace for us, we need to understand consistency is not just a demand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes of us, but consistency is our ally. It helps us. We understood in South Africa that you can't fight racism by being racist to yourself. You can't fight an unfree system by putting unfree proposals in front. You can't fight for equality, but you don't want women to be equal. We must understand, as we dissect the society and the troubles that we face, that we have grandparents called fear and ignorance. Their one child prejudice met and married discrimination. And they had a number of children. Their children was racism. The other child was Islamophobia. The other child was sexism. The other child was xenophobia. Another child is homophobia. Another child is anti-Semitism. And so we can go on. All the children who manifest, the parents and the grandparents, are all our enemies. You can have your views about a matter and about a lifestyle, but you can't be prejudiced against a person. And therefore, if you want to fight Islamophobia, don't be racist. Don't be sexist. Don't be xenophobic. Don't display any discrimination, because the moment you display a discrimination against others, you give others a right to discriminate against you, because you are saying it's okay as long as it doesn't happen to me. You see, that's the complexity of living here. When you are in a majority Muslim country, everyone looks like you, prays like you, thinks like you, talks like you, dresses like you, and eats what you eat. Prejudice and discrimination doesn't come in. But it is when you are here in a multicultural, diverse society that you are tested. Then the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ about no difference between a black and a white and an Arab and a non-Arab really applies to you. When you don't really see non-Arabs, it's okay. When you don't really see black people, it's okay. But where you live with them, they are your neighbors, they are your colleagues at work, they are friends at school, then all of those things matter. And therefore, we have to have consistency of our goal and consistency of our means. We are so open and vulnerable because people don't always believe that when we stand for something, that there is no contradiction in it. I told some of the brothers who were fighting around the New York mosque that was being opposed in America. I said, you know, and I know it's controversial, but it has to be said. I said, you know, the best way to fight for a mosque in New York is to fight for a church in Saudi Arabia. Because otherwise, we will always be mistrusted in our intention. The very essence of Islam, we are being suspected. And so, those are the challenges. And when we admit to that, my dear brothers and sisters, the Prophet ﷺ has taught us another wonderful lesson. He has taught us the example of the Khilful Fudul, the alliance, the coalition of the virtuous. When he referred to something that happened before Nubuwa, when someone was mistreated, a Yemeni trader was mistreated, the tribes and the people of Makkah came together and they entered into a Khilful Fudul to ensure that no other trader will ever be shortchanged and discriminated against in Makkah ever. The Prophet ﷺ later, after Nubuwa, recalled this and said, I was present at the house of, I think, Abdullah ibn Judan, where there was an excellent pact, the alliance of the virtuous, the Khilful Fudul. And if today in Islam I were called upon to do the same, I would gladly respond. You see, what Rasulullah ﷺ is telling us is to enter into these coalitions. They don't all have to be principled alliances, because we don't always agree with the end goals of others. But they can be strategic. And they don't all have to be strategic. Sometimes they can be tactical. But it is the hikmah, it is the wisdom of knowing what to do at what moment, and not the fear of doing, that will allow us to utilize this interregnum that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided us with. And so, to end, I believe that the primary task that we need to get right, that should be an uncompromising goal, is to build trust. We so often forget that before the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was Rasulullah, he was Al-Amin. Before he was the messenger of God, he was the trustworthy. You cannot give the message if you have not built trust. So many of us are so eager to give this message, but so few of us do the hard things to build trust. And trust is when your sword of justice goes to those you oppose as well as those who speak in your name. There is no trust that is to be built when it is easy to criticize the West, but not those who act in our name and misuse our religion and abuse our symbols and invoke our scriptures in destructive ways. You've got to build trust, but you also have to build trust by the friendliness with your neighbor. Your hijab is not the barrier. It is the thing that allows you to interact. Your iman does not confer chosen status to you. It gives you a mission to engage, to reveal yourself, to reveal your soul to the others so that they may see the beauty of Islam. And that returns me to where I started, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised Nasrun min Allah wa fathun qareeb, that help from Allah will come and a speedy victory. The irony, my brothers and sisters, is that the word fath, which means victory, is also the word that means to open. Hence Fatiha, the opening. If you think you win a military battle but you close the hearts that you have won for Islam, you have lost for Islam. If what you do to create a victory for the Ummah, and by that you fill the hearts with fear for the Ummah, you have lost the battle for Islam. If you believe that there is a military victory but not a victory of opening the souls and the hearts and the minds to Islam, you have lost. And that is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I refer you to read it yourself, in the surah called Suratul Fath, the chapter on victory, look for a battle in there. You won't find a battle. What you will find is what we often accuse our leaders of selling out, of compromising, of negotiation. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us there is that strength of Islam is not hardware. It's not the hard power of Islam that is the guarantor of openness. It's the soft power of Islam. When we live out the attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ar-Rahman, the most merciful, and yet we are harsh. The mission of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is rahmatul lil alameen, a mercy unto all of creation, and yet we operate in this world as if all of creation will fear us. The definition of the ummah is ummatan wasatan, the ummah that strives to be in the middle and not on the extremes. The definition of Islam itself derives from the word peace, and yet no peaceful connotations are put to us. We've got to win trust by returning to those maqasid, returning to those intents, returning to those fundamental values. And if we are able to do that, then inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make us an ummah that will use this interregnum for the benefit of the ummah, to give new leadership to the ummah, and to be able to create, not only in Britain, but all over the world, the abode of those who freely believe, the abode of those who are secure with each other, the abode of those who are at peace with each other. That is the ultimate objective. And I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives guidance to the new leadership of the MCB, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthens you in your support of them, in your giving your mandate to them, inshallah, that they may be able to do the tasks that is done, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them the hikmah to be able to understand when to act globally and when to do things locally, when to influence leaders in parliament and in cabinet, and when to keep the grassroots going, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala understands, gives them the understanding of how to act as Muslims and also how to act as British Muslims as they give leadership to this ummah, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives all of you the patience and the wisdom to know what to do with this moment, inshallah, because the whole world will watch how you deal with your crises. If you win your crisis here in the best way possible, then it makes it possible for the whole ummah to rise again, to dream again, and to have a vision of itself and to reimagine itself. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.